graduate student here at Medill, and I am set to graduate in June, so if any of you are hiring, you let me know. I do want to welcome you all here to Medill's annual Beyond the Box Score lecture series. This is part of Medill Sports Immersion Program. Tonight, I am honored to welcome to the stage a father-son duo that has truly etched their name in the game of basketball, both at the NBA and the collegiate level. Their track records are quite impressive. I will start with Don Collins. Doug Collins, I am so sorry. Oh my gosh. Yeah. You want to take those job offers back, I completely understand. Doug has spent four decades in the world of basketball, not only as a player, as a coach, but also as a commentator. He was a four-time NBA All-Star, and he was also the number one overall pick in the 1973 draft. He currently works as an NBA analyst for ESPN, and in 2009, he was inducted into the Naismith Memorial Basketball Hall of Fame, and he also received the Kurt Gowdy Media Award. Everybody, please welcome. Next, I'd like to welcome his son and Northwestern's head basketball coach, Chris Collins. I got this one. Chris Collins. Coach Collins just finished his first year coaching the Wildcats. And in that first year, he led the team to a victory over eventual Final Four participant Wisconsin. And he also led the team to their first three-game road winning streak since 1960. Yeah. Wow. Pretty impressive. So far, so good. Before coming to Evanston, he spent 13 years as part of the coaching staff at Duke, and with them, he helped lead the team to two national championships. He's also a local of Northbrook, and in 1992, he was voted Illinois' Mr. Basketball in 1992. Everybody, please put your hands together for Chris Collins. And lastly, moderating tonight's conversation, we have Dave Revsine, who is the lead studio host at the Big Ten Network. Not only is Dave a Northwestern graduate, he also was the first on-air hire talent for the Big Ten Network. Other than the various roles he has at BTN, he also does play-by-play announcing for various Big Ten basketball games. Please welcome Dave. If anybody is tweeting tonight, please feel free to use the hashtag NUCollins. Again, I feel like terrible for getting that wrong, even though I'm a huge fan and love listening to you commentate on just about any NBA game. Anyway, thank you all so much for joining us tonight. And with that, I will hand it off to Dave to start this conversation. Welcome.
Thank you, Karen. Thanks. Well, first of all, it's an honor to be here. As Karen said, I'm a Northwestern graduate, and it's always fun to come back to NU. I'm also a graduate of Glenbrook North, like Chris, so we have that nice connection. There's so much to talk about with both of these guys, and we are somewhat limited on our time, and so I felt it was important that we narrow the scope a little bit. In fact, we were talking a little bit earlier, Doug and I and Chris were, about the 1972 Olympics. Yes. Doug and I did a whole show about one game in the 1972 Olympics, and we talked about that gold medal game for an hour.
Yes.
So there's obviously a ton of stuff that we could talk about, but what I'm going to do is center the discussion on the basketball bond between Doug and Chris and kind of use that as our focus and the way that we center this conversation. If during the question and answer portion at the end, if you'd like to go in a different direction, by all means, please do that. But with that in mind, I know you guys talk every day. Chris has told me that before. What would you say is the ratio, Doug, of how much of that conversation is about basketball to how much of it is about everything else?
Probably 99-1. The 1% is about Brian and Kate, my grandkids. The bond we have, Dave, with that is, I can't even explain it. I think the fun thing from my standpoint is is that he calls me as much as I call him. And so it's always nice when you hear from them. And we're at such a, I think, a stage of our lives, both of us, we're in such a great place. You know, I'm no longer coaching. He's just starting. And I just want to be a sounding board for him, really. Just, and we don't talk about the X's and O's aspect of it as much as the relationships and what he's trying to build and what he's trying to go through at this particular time. So it's very special, you know, because I didn't have that kind of relationship with my father.
What are your first father-son basketball memories, Chris?
It's pretty amazing. I remember him being a player back in the 70s. He played for the Philadelphia 76ers, and I always tell the story. It's incredible if you look at it in the family room of that team, the 1977 Sixer team. I was 4 years old. They lost the Portland Trail Blazers with Bill Walton in the championship game. But if you look at the guys on that team, they always have a family room in the NBA where all the families go at halftime, before games, after games. Well, the kids that were hanging out in that family room during that time, my dad obviously was on the team, so you had myself, who played at Duke and has now been in basketball. The point guard was Henry Bibby, whose son Mike Bibby won a national championship at Arizona, longtime NBA player, NBA All-Star. Backup point guard, Mike Dunleavy Sr., who Mike Jr., you know, I ended up coaching at Duke and is now on the Bulls, and we won a national championship together. Forward on that team was a guy named Harvey Catchings, whose daughter Tamika Catchings is one of the greatest women's players to ever play. And then there was a backup forward on that team named Joe Bryant, who had a son named Kobe. So it's amazing that we all were little kids running around, playing Nerf ball, hanging around the locker rooms, chasing our dads around. And, you know, those are my first memories of being around that Sixer team.
What do you remember about him as a player? I mean, do you have any games that are etched into your memory in any way, or were you too young to really comprehend that kind of stuff?
I always used to watch, because we used to have the old VHS tapes. I used the series against Portland. I used to watch the first two games because I think he had like 33 in game one and 30 and just was killing it in those two games. They had a big fight in game two. Yeah. Daryl Dawkins got in a fight with Maurice Lucas, and guys were throwing punches, and it changed the series, actually.
Yeah,
Philly was up 2-0. And ended up losing four straight. So I used to always watch those old games, anything I could get my hands on. I was always such a big nut. I mean, with all sports, but basketball in particular, I would tag along as much as I could. I always watched the game. He never had to show me the way. Ever since I can remember, I love being in the gym and being around it.
Do you remember the moment that you kind of introduced Chris to basketball, or maybe were cognizant of the fact that the kid's into basketball?
Well, you know, the one thing I wanted to do was I wanted Chris to be able to be around it. And if he loved it, I wanted him to do it. And my big thing was with Kelly or Chris was always, if you're going to do it well. You know, the one thing I always used to say in the house, don't ever tell me you didn't do well because it didn't mean anything. If you took the time to do it well. And so what I used to do was, when I was playing in Philadelphia, I used to speak at a lot of summer basketball camps, go up in the Poconos. You could speak in three camps in one day. You know, back then, they'd give you $500 to speak at a camp. I mean, you get $1,500. That was a lot of money. And I would take Chris with me, and he would go up, and he'd be out there, and he'd be watching me lecture. And I think probably Chris would tell you he probably learned more being around it and listening to me speak to mass groups of coaching, of teaching, of being in high school basketball camps, of having my own camps, rather than me speaking one-on-one to him. I always was very fearful of wanting to be looked at as somebody who's pushing their child to do something. I didn't want him to look at me as his coach. I wanted to be his dad. You know, that was important to me. I wanted to be his dad. And the thing about it is, he's always had great coaches. It's funny, you know, Brian James is down here, who was his high school coach. He goes to Duke. He's got Coach K. He never needed me to be his coach. I just wanted to be his dad.
You mentioned your relationship with your father being very different.
Yeah.
What was the nature of that relationship?
Well, it's funny. I grew up, my dad was a county sheriff. And so I grew up in the jail, county jail. True story.
You don't want to go into the family business?
true story. My dad was a sheriff, a county sheriff.
Right.
It was a community of 6,000 people. I lived upstairs. The jail was downstairs. I was like Opie. You know, it was my father was the sheriff, my uncle was a deputy, and my grandmother was the cook. And so I grew up in, I mean, I was taught if there was a quarter laying on the floor, that's not yours, don't pick it up. Or we're going to walk you back here and put you in that cell because you took something that didn't belong to you kind of thing. But I think it was a generation, Dave, of where parents weren't as warm and fuzzy kind of thing. It's like there wasn't a lot of the communication. You know, I can't imagine going a day without telling Chris and Kelly how much I love them. But, you know, as a kid, I never heard that. I knew my dad did. But the thing I respected about him, never once did he ever come to one of my practices. Never, he would always come to the games. He didn't play question and answer after the games with me. His two biggest thing was always, I'm proud of you, son. And that was it. And so he was a good man. He died too young. He died, actually, it was a very tough time for me. We were playing the Portland Trailblazers. I found out he had terminal cancer, so we had to play through that. And then the next year, he passed away as we were getting ready to play, or right after we played the conference finals against Washington. So age 57, he went way too young. And so I just made sure that as a man, that I never let that time slip away with my kids. That was important to me.
You've been a public figure for Chris's entire life. I think that's got to be challenging.
Very.
What did you tell him about the fact that everyone knew who you were?
I didn't want that to be a curse for him. I wanted him to look upon that as a blessing, and that he got exposed to things that maybe other kids didn't get to. So, you know, when things were being said or whatever, I would try to say, like, Chris, understand now, you're in the locker room right now getting Michael Jordan's shoes, getting ready for him to get ready to go play a playoff game. There's not many kids that have that opportunity. And so it is hard being... I can only imagine what it is today with social media. I mean, it's a whole different world with the Twitter and the blogging and the internet and everything. I mean, Chris is, you know, it's funny, we talk about all the time. I'm not very tech savvy at all. I just learned how to use an iPad recently. My daughter taught me. But he said, Dad, you want to see something very interesting? He, you know, we just beat Wisconsin. He said, I can pull up 200 Twitters here that tell me I have no idea what I'm doing as a coach. He said, so if I want to read that, I can really be crazy. And I said, smart, don't read it, because it'll make you start doing stuff that you got to believe. But there's always somebody out there who's a critic. And it's a tough business out, it really is. And that's where I try to be there for Chris. I try, you know, I'm his dad. I'm going to try to protect him.
How aware were you of what an unusual childhood that was, Chris?
I don't think I was fully aware until maybe I got here to Chicago. We moved here when I was going into the seventh grade. You know, I think as a young kid, you just kind of think that's what you're supposed to do. I remember, funny story, you know, being in Philadelphia was such a great sports town, and my dad was friends with all the guys on the Phillies and all the Eagles, and, you know, so we would go to games, and after the game, we're going and hanging out with Ron Jaworski or Mike Schmidt, and, you know, I remember my mom took me and my sister out to San Francisco where her brother lived. And he took us to an Oakland A's game. And we're at the game and we're hanging out and the game's getting ready to end. And I must have been 7 years old, 8 years old. And he said, all right, let's go. The game's over. And I went crazy. I said, why aren't we going down to the clubhouse to meet with the players? So I just kind of, you know, and then once I got to Chicago, and certainly that was such a special time because it was right in the heyday of Jordan's prime.
Yeah.
You know, so, and I was at an age of, you know, I was 13 years old. So, you know, going to my school and just kind of the buzz of, you know, the new Bulls coach's kid was there. I think I fully started to understand kind of what that all meant, who I was, and, you know, I think it's helped me through the years. I mean, it's certainly helped me in my career as you learn how to be tough because of all the things, you know, you hear the criticisms of your dad and living through things positively, negatively, and I think it's helped me get thicker skin because in order to survive and being a public figure, and you got to understand that in sports, it's what's beautiful about sports. People have opinions. You know, they're gonna agree, they're gonna disagree, they're gonna question, they're gonna applaud you, and in order to be successful and to do it for a long time, you gotta be tough.
What about the pressure component as a kid?
You know, I tried to use it as a positive. You know, I think I was always very proud of who my dad was, but I hated, like, as I was growing into high school, I wanted to be my own player and I wanted to have my own merits. I hated that every time it was always son of Doug Collins, you know, and I tried to use it as my motivation to shed that label, you know, at one of these days, you know, not that I wasn't proud of everything my dad's done, but I wanted to be my own guy. So I used that very much as motivation as a player. And I think part of that's part of the reason why I might be, wanted to coach in college. You know, the NBA was kind of his thing. And I always wanted to create my own niche in basketball. So I think that's one of the reasons why I wanted to coach in college initially was to kind of create my own identity.
And Dave, on the, yeah. on the flip side of that, my proudest moment when they said, aren't you Chris Collins' dad?
When was the first time that happened? When was the first time?
Let me try to think. I think it might have been somebody coming at his press conference, I think, when he took the job here at Northwestern. And right. and being you know being there and sending around and somebody coming up and saying, you know, this is Chris Collins' dad. And that was an incredibly proud moment for me.
You know what I found interesting, Chris? You talk a lot about being your own man, and you and I have spoken about that in the past, and yet you chose to wear the same number that yeah. your dad wore. Why did you do that? Why did you wear number 20?
Probably just because as a kid, you know, you always idolize your parents. And, you know, it was just kind of our family number. And I started with it early, and you know, something that my sister ended up wearing it. My own son now wears it, so it's pretty cool. It's kind of like our family thing.
You talked about the coaching the Bulls, and when you guys moved to Chicago, and that was kind of when it started to sink in for you. That was such an amazing time in this city, yeah. having lived through it. For you in that position. How, I mean, you're always thinking about your family. As parents, yes. we always are. And of course, you're thinking about your job and how you're going to win the next game. But what were you thinking in terms of how this was going to impact your family and what the best way to kind of mold that was?
Well, the amazing thing is when I came to coach the Bulls, I mean, Michael hadn't really become Michael yet. He was just tasting it. He had just come off the big series against the Boston Celtics. He'd come off a broken foot, missed all but about 18 games that year, had the spectacular playoff series. And, I mean, he was just starting to be, you know, Michael Jordan. I'll never forget, they didn't really sell even Bulls T-shirts in the city. The Bulls were way down the list. I mean, Bears, you know, Cubs, Blackhawks, I mean, and then the Bulls. And then really Michael's stardom just the meteoric rise, and to be a part and to watch this man every single day, just the way he did his job and to be a part of things. The thing about it is I had a story about Chris, about the Bulls was, I remember somebody asked him one day what it's like to go watch the Bulls practice and to watch Scottie Pippen and Michael Jordan. And he said, you know what, I really don't watch Scottie Pippen and Michael Jordan. I watch John Paxson because I think I can be John Paxson. And I thought that was pretty, you know, I said, that's pretty damn sharp. You know, it's like, you know, he's not going to be my, but he said, I think I can be John Paxson. And he was a lot like John Paxson. And had Chris gotten into the right spot at the right time, Chris could have played in the NBA for a few years.
What did you learn, Chris, basketball-wise, from hanging around those guys, other than it sounds like about your own limitations?
I mean, I think the main thing, the games were awesome. I was a ball boy. I used to sit under the basket. When guys fell down in the lane, I had to run out there and wipe the sweat up with the towel and you know, which the old Chicago Stadium. I mean, that was amazing to be a part of those atmospheres. But you know, I think the practices was where I really learned because I loved the game. I wanted to be a player. You know, everyone always asks me, "Did you always grow up wanting to be a coach?" And the answer is absolutely not. I grew up wanting to be a player. You know, your dreams were to go play in college, to go to the NBA. And so for me to be able to go to those practices and watch how hard those, I mean, I didn't model myself after Michael, but I think the thing that really, you know, was great for me to see was how hard he worked. And he tried to win every drill. He was so competitive. No one worked harder. He never had a day where he didn't show up ready to compete and ready to work. And, you know, I think those were the things that really made an impression on me was, man, if I want to be good, I got to work at this, you know, and you got to put the time and effort in.
You were talking about this earlier, the idea not necessarily of teaching, but more of putting him in a position to observe.
Yes.
And it sounds like that's a lot of what you're talking about. But at the end of the day, when you guys went home and you talked about what you had observed, what was that What was that question and answer like?
Well, we would talk a little bit about that. The memories I remember most is just, we both loved the game so much, is watching games together. You know, just, you know, you have dinner and then, you know, you finish your homework or whatever, and then just before you go to watching a couple hours where college games, pro games. That's how I learned basketball, really. Just, I mean,
give me a sense of that conversation. Is it, okay, Chris, what defense are they in?
Yeah, the analyst you see on ESPN, that's what I was getting on the couch.
Right.
You know, I mean, that's...
I would ask him questions like, what did you see on that? Like, tell me what, you know, the great play, but did you see anything? How'd that happen? And it was pretty neat. We had two long couches, and I never forget, you know, the satellite dishes finally came out. We had this gigantic, looked like a UFO in our backyard, where, you know, that point, there was no NBA league pass then, right, where you could get every game, every night. And so we would do that. And that's one of the things I missed when Chris went to college. That was the reality that I would look at a game and watch a game, and the couch was empty. He was at Duke. I didn't have my buddy there with me anymore.
And I know you've told me you do that with your son, right?
Yeah.
So have you tried to kind of, do you do it the same way that your dad did it?
You know, we're a little bit different. You know, I think it's similar.
Chairs rather than couches.
Yeah, we got the, you know, but it's been fun. My son's 11 now, so he's kind of just old enough to know all the guys and kind of understand what's going on. I think the thing that's really helped me is, you know, having a dad who was a coach and knowing the demands that he had to put into his job. And I mean, I was on the other side of it. I was the kid at one point. So, you know, I think it's helped me as a dad because I remember the things that meant the most to me, you know, just watching a game together or showing up at one of his games and the things that I was upset about, but the things that made me happy. So I think that's really helped me being a coach and having a kid is I was in my son's shoes. So I think I understand that dynamic a little bit better.
What were the most important things to you?
I just think, you know, those times, any time that he could be there. You know, I knew his job was demanding. The NBA a lot more so. I mean, 82 games, you're on the road a lot. So, you know, any time he could be at one of my games or be at a practice or just to be able to go in the backyard and shoot hoops and talk about the game. I mean, those were things that really mattered to me.
When you talk about being in your yard and playing, I mean, you know, obviously at that point, certainly you're still very, very capable of competing with Doug or with Chris. Did you guys have one-on-ones and that type of, is there great Santini in the backyard?
I was a little lame. I'd hurt my knees and I had a lot of injuries. So I was having some hip problems. So, and I was not moving too well, so I had to reach and grab a little bit. But I'll never forget, he was, I always told Chris, I said, and Kelly, I will never let you beat me. You're going to have to beat me. And then when you do, it'll mean something to you. I'm not going to throw the game, so you can go in there and be happy that you're going to have to beat me. And so he was 13, and we were playing, and he beat me. And I shook his hand, I said, that's it. You beat me, I'm done. It's yours. Go. We're done.
What do you recall about that day?
It was physical.
Were you pointing to 11?
I don't remember the exact total, but just on his point, I think I'm so happy that he was like that with me because it's one of the reasons why I'm as competitive as I am. Because I know, you know, there were so many times that I didn't win. And you're running into the house and you're crying and, you know, you're upset. And it was true. He said, you will know when you beat me, whatever it is, basketball, wiffle ball, whatever we're playing, you won. Like, I didn't give you the game. You beat me. And it's one of the reasons why I think I'm as competitive as I am was because of growing up in that kind of environment.
So it sounds like competitiveness is something that you guys both share. And I think it's evident to anyone who has observed you guys through the years. What are other similarities you see between yourself and Chris, whether it was as a player or as a coach?
He does have my competitiveness. He has got a very good mind. And I'm not saying that arrogantly, I don't mean that, but I feel like I have a really good mind. I have a very good memory. I don't forget anything. Just to give you a little idea, the other day, we're in the green room there at ESPN getting ready to go in our studio, and Dallas is down two against San Antonio with like 1.4 seconds to go on the clock. Ginobili's just scored. And they get into an alignment on a play. And I said, watch Vince Carter on this. It's BJ's play. We ran it for Lou Williams, and he hit a corner three against Charlotte to beat them, and we beat them in overtime when I was in Philly. I said, so keep your eye on Vince Carter. If they fall asleep on this, he's going to get a corner three. You know, he hit the corner three, and they sort of looked at me. I said, it's a blessing and it's a curse. I remember everything, but it's sometimes my mind doesn't shut off. And I think Chris does a better job of that than I do and did. I will tell you, I think Chris has a great blend. I think he has the best of me and the best of his mother.
Okay, so what are the characteristics that are the best of his mother? For those who aren't familiar with you, what are those differences?
Probably a little bit more patient. I'm one of these guys where, you know, if something's going on, I want to fix it now. I don't like to let things. Chris is much better at saying, okay, let's just see how this plays itself out, kind of thing. I think he has a little bit more patience with that. I'm more of a, let's get this thing fixed so we can get it moving in the right direction. Sometimes my competitiveness gets the best of me, and I think he channels that better. I think he does a better job I can't sleep when I get something on my mind. Chris has this unique ability that if something's pressing, to take care of it, but if not, he just allows it to. He's not as combative as I am.
What would you say to that question? You agree with that assessment, Chris?
Probably so. Yeah, probably. I mean, we both have a lot of fire in us, and we're both ultimately competitive. I don't know what the right word. I mean, at times, just my demeanor, I think at times can be a little bit calmer with certain situations.
Was that because you saw the toll that it took on your dad? I mean,
maybe a little bit. I think part of it is just people have different personalities.
Yeah.
You know, I don't
right.
know if it's something that I sense that from him. I think it's just everyone to me is wired differently. And I was always taught, whether it was from my dad or the years I was with Coach K, is, you know, you want to be in situations where you learn and you have mentors and you're always learning. You never have all the answers. You can always learn. But at the end of the day, when it's time for you to be in leadership position, you can't try to be someone else. Like, right. I can't try to be him. I can't try to be Coach K. I have to be me. And so what I try to do is just be myself. And I just think we have different personalities in certain ways.
The great Chuck Daly, who was one of my assistant coaches in Philadelphia and a dear, dear friend of mine, he said something a long time ago. He said, you can't fool dogs, kids, or players. And I think it's what Chris was talking about, is those players that you're leading, the people that you're leading, I don't care what leadership position, people know who you are based upon, are you consistent on a daily basis? That's the one thing. I was always consistent. I was always consistent, I was always fair, and I was always honest, sometimes too honest. And as I look back on it, sometimes you gotta, you know, even though something might be the truth, sometimes you might just not be able to say it. You can't be deceptive, but sometimes maybe you can't say it. And I've always been one, I'm the classic overachiever, Dave. You know, people look up here at me right now. I mean, if you'd have told me I would have had 40 minutes in the NBA instead of 40 years, I mean, when I was 1968 in high school, my high school team, I didn't even start on my high school team. And in 1972, I'm shooting two free throws for a gold medal in the Olympics. And in 1973, I'm the first pick in the draft. And Chris will tell you, I've always been driven that someone's not going to take my job. Like, somebody out there every day is going to try to. When I broadcast, I probably prepare more than I have to. You would probably not know if I did 20 hours of preparation, 40, but I would know, just like you would know,
yeah,
Dave.
That's that business. Part
you know
of it
that.
Is. Yeah,
I mean,
no,
you could get away
yep.
because you're good
yes.
with doing 20 hours of work, but when you were on air, there'd be that one thing missing, like, you know what? I didn't get my work done.
Absolutely, and you don't feel comfortable.
And so when you speak,
absolutely.
There's a little
yep.
less confidence because you say, you know what? I didn't do all my homework.
Right.
And I've always been one to do more than my homework. And I got hurt because I drove myself so hard because I always felt somebody was going to take my job.
And I think what's interesting, particularly in a career in sports, is there's always going to be failure.
Oh,
right?
Sure.
And so, I mean, I think the failure that must have really struck a chord with both of you guys, I'm sure you still think about, that I think about, was when you got fired by the Bulls.
Sure.
I mean, I remember where I was when you got fired by the Bulls, okay?
No doubt.
So take me through what that was like as a father.
Oh, it was hard, you know. It was very, very hard, you know, especially Chris was just starting to play high school.
Right.
You know, and so, I mean, just the things that the kids would yell to him when he was playing, I mean, it was brutal. I mean, kids can be very mean.
Kind of stuff with people say.
Oh, just whatever. I mean, I can't use it here. I mean, it was awful. But... you know, the one thing, it was interesting because when I got fired, it's the first time I was ever told I wasn't needed in my lifetime.
Yeah.
And that hurts. That really hurts. But it's really the first time you ever really look at yourself and evaluate, say, okay, they don't need me. And you really grow from that experience. But the growth I hope that I gave Chris and Kelly was... Before I came to Chicago, I lived in Arizona. I coached at Arizona State for a couple years. I did not like the recruiting. And so I said, I can't do college. And so when we came from Arizona, we loved living in Arizona. We came back to Chicago. When I got fired, I thought, I want to move back. I want to get away from this. And I want to go back to Arizona. And Chris and Kelly didn't want to leave. They wanted to stay in Chicago. And so I said, the greatest gift I can give my kids is to show them how I handle this. And it's interesting, I did talk show radio on The Score when it first came. I had a bull show on The Score. And everybody listened to any word I said for any bitterness, any jealousy, any envy. And I said, there isn't any, because I wouldn't want to be anybody else. And I think that hopefully I make them understand, you can never run away. You got to face it. And when you face it, you're better for it. And that's what I try to do.
What do you remember about that time?
Man, I remember the day vividly. I was actually at Glenbrook North High School. I was in ninth grade, and we had a summer basketball camp. So you went there, and they had just had a great run. I mean, that was the double pump Jordan shot over Elo.
Right.
You know, then they beat the Knicks in the conference semis, take the Pistons to six games.
Right.
I mean, that was like the thought of that
they're
he could
the
lose
cup.
His
they
job.
Right there. Yeah.
I mean, it was nothing but forward growth. So I was at our high school, Coach James, who's here, my high school coach. We worked out in the morning and I rode my bike, you know, from my home to the couple miles. And I remember going back and riding my bike home. And then from the distance outside my house, I saw all these like news trucks right outside of my house. I mean, there was a crowd of people. And I'm a 14-year-old kid, and I just as soon as I throw my bike down, all these microphones are thrown in my face. I just like lost it emotionally. You know, how do you feel? Your dad's just been fired. And I like ran and went into the front door, and my parents grabbed me, and it was a pretty traumatic day. I mean, that was pretty tough.
It's amazing too, the difference in that time, right? Because certainly today, it wouldn't have taken you getting all the way home. I remember I was working downtown. I remember. And there was like an extra, the Sun-Times did an extra on it.
Right.
And that was when I saw it, right? But you would have known now, you would have known in 10 seconds.
You know, the one thing I hope, you know, is Chris now being a coach.
Yeah.
And you can see what's going on in coaching now. I mean, look at the coaches that got fired last year. I mean, Lionel Hollins and Vinny Del Negro and George Karl all had career years with their team. I mean, Mark Jackson just got fired today, winning 51 games or whatever. And I told Chris, I said, I want you to remember this. A lot of times they're going to make a coaching change. It doesn't mean they're getting a better coach. It just means they're getting a different one because they don't know if they're getting a better one yet.
Right.
That will time will tell. And I just think you have to keep it in perspective. It's an incredibly personal thing, Dave. And it's the one thing I'm really ultra sensitive about when I work on the air. If the people I'm around start getting reckless about guys getting fired and who's on the hot seat or whatever, I let them know, don't talk about that around me. The coach can deal with that, but the peripheral love of family gets crushed. And so let's be a little bit more sensitive when we start throwing around people's livelihoods. And understand, if you want to talk about that guy, that's okay. But all the people that are with him suffer. And I just think we get a little reckless sometimes with the things we throw out there and how we put people on the hot seat and who's going to lose their jobs and stuff. And that's a thing I'm incredibly sensitive about.
While we're on the topic of disappointment, I mean, you know, Chris, you mentioned earlier, look, you ultimately want to be a player. You want to play in the NBA, and your dad was talking about maybe had the situation been right. You had a brilliant career. Karen was talking about Mr. Basketball in Illinois. You went to Duke. You were part of some great teams there. I know you played professionally in Europe as well. But not being able to make that step where you didn't end up in the NBA, what was that like, and what did your dad have to say about that?
Well, it was actually a great story. You know, I played overseas for a year, and then I came back, and I went to veterans camp with Minnesota Timberwolves. And that was at a time they had Stephon Marbury, Kevin Garnett, Tom Gugliotta, where, like, their Flip Saunders was the coach. And I was in, you know, a non-guaranteed guy trying to fight for a spot and kind of went in there with no expectations because I didn't really know. I just was trying to fight every day to have them keep me around. And it's just so funny how life works. The first preseason game we had was against the Detroit Pistons, and he was coaching.
What do you think his mom was cheering for?
And he was coaching.
It's the preseason,
not a quarterback. Yeah, right. And my high school coach was his assistant. Right. So I remember Flip told me before the game, he's like, look, no matter what, I'll put you in. So I'm like thinking, man, you know, maybe in the fourth quarter, you know, he'll put me. So we're going through the game, it's first half, and with about 3 minutes to go in the first half, we're in a timeout, and all the starters on both teams are in. Grant Hill's on the other team, who was my college teammate, Joe Dumars. And he's like, Chris, you're in. I was like, oh, man, this is crazy. So my heart's racing. You're playing in an NBA game. It's even though it's preseason, it's unbelievable. Your dad's coaching the other team. So all of a sudden, it's under a minute in the first half, and Flip calls a 20-second timeout. It's our ball. So he diagrams a play for me to get a shot. And later, I've talked to Grant about it, and Grant's one of my great friends. He's my teammate. He said in the huddle that him and Lindsey Hunter and Joe, whatever you do, do not let him score. We'll never hear the end of it. So we run a play, and they mess up, and they don't switch right. Garnett sets a screen for me. I come off at the top of the key, bury a three. And
looks at me and goes, don't you know I can make this shot, Dad? Am I in the scouting report?
Yeah. So went through preseason and kind of just kept hanging around. And then actually got let go the day before the regular season. I was the last person cut.
The Lakers cut Dwan Wheat. Okay. And Minnesota picked him up, or Chris would have made the team. Flip told me.
And ended up, at that time, it was difficult. Playing in Europe was very tough at that time because there wasn't email, there wasn't internet, there wasn't, you know, Skype. You know, when you went over there, you were just over there. You weren't getting the games. And I was such a basketball, I just missed home. I love the playing aspect of it, but I was so lonely from home, you know, being away, that I really didn't want to go back to Europe. You know, the minor league system was kind of in flux, and so I had to kind of make a decision what career path I wanted to choose. And, you know, I went back to Detroit. I was hanging around and kind of figuring out my next move because my parents were there. And I would sit in on all the coaches' meetings. I would be, you know, at practices kind of learning about coaching. And they actually came up to me and said, we're going to start a WNBA franchise. We're going to call it the Detroit Shock. You know, we're going to hire a former player, Nancy Lieberman, to be the coach. She's never coached, but she was a great player, and you know, we want her to kind of be a figurehead, and we'd love for you to be her assistant and learn how to coach. It was a summer. The WNBA plays in the summertime, and just give it a try and see if you like coaching. So I ended up doing it, and I always say, you know, the thing that was great about it, I was totally at peace with my career as a player. You know, I felt like I maxed out who I was. You know, I thought I could have kept playing. I could have been a guy who played in Europe, maybe made a team, got cut, you know, one of those journeyman type guys. But I felt like I maxed out who I could be. I thought I was the best I could be as a player, and I was excited about becoming a coach and starting my new journey. And I think it really helped me. Now that I look back on it, I just turned 40, but I have 18 years of coaching experience because I didn't hang around and play for 10 years. Like, I got right into it. So I'm still young, but I have a ton of experience. I think it's helped me in my coaching career. So
you know, that, Dave, just along the one conversation Chris and I had was when he got let in Minnesota, and he was sort of not sure what he wanted to do. And we were talking one day, and I said, Chris, just do me a favor. Make sure you get the playing out of your system. Don't ever look back with any regrets that there was more in the tank. And when you're ready to move on, only you will know that. And I was incredibly proud, because when you give up, like Chris will tell you, there's nothing like being a player, nothing. If you ask any player, anybody who's older, if you had one day that you could do whatever you wanted to do, say, like, take me back to my prime and let me play one game. Just let me play one more game. There's nothing like it. So when you give that up, there's a piece of you that goes, because that locker room is never the same. That locker room for a player and for a coach is a whole different. Now, you might be in there, but you're not a player. And it's a whole different world. And I was really proud of Chris. And another thing along those lines, you know, people think Chris was given this silver spoon. And that irritates me, because he's worked hard to be where he is. He did the Detroit Shock and worked very, very hard there to help Nancy Liebman. Went to Seton Hall with Tommy Amaker, and then went with Coach K, obviously. The thing he's done, and I always told him, when you get an opportunity, take advantage of it. And he's done that. And so this idea that he's just handed stuff or whatever, that could be no further from the truth. And even though he's my son or whatever, there's nobody who's worked harder to be where he is today than Chris.
So now all of a sudden you guys are in the same business, right? When he takes this Detroit Shock, assistant coach job.
Yes.
So, I mean, at a certain, you had to have in the back of your mind, based on all this time you guys had spent observing basketball, talking about basketball, you had to have thought there was a distinct possibility this day would come.
Yeah.
But when all of a sudden he is a coach, when you go from that advice of how to end your playing career to how to start your coaching career, what does that sound like?
I always said, be around people smarter than you are. Learn every day. And, you know, when I think about it, I think about Chris, Glenbrook North High School, incredible high school. How many of those kids, how successful? Dave, you know, you went there.
Yes.
What, 99% of them go on, get to college, and have incredible careers? I mean, Chris to this day will run into people. His high school teammates come to his games now, and they're his biggest fans. They're all incredibly successful business guys. He went to Duke. And you think about the people you're with Duke, not just the basketball players, but how
it's
many
a
of those?
Poor man's Northwestern.
There you go. And now, one of the things about Chris is, I was more of a deterrent along this line than him. I wasn't sure about Northwestern.
Right.
Because all I'd seen was tremendous failure. And I'm going, are they committed? Are they committed with the money and the resources to get, do they really want to have a big time program? Because if they do, I knew it would be a great spot for him, because it's the kind of people he wants to be around. That's all he's ever known. But he'll tell you, like when he started talking about Northwestern, like I sort of shut down a little bit or whatever. Like I didn't say much. I just listened. I could just feel the passion he had about coming here. And then when I met Dr. Phillips and I met Dr. Shapiro, I knew he was in the right spot, because they love Chris and they believe in him. And that was my biggest concern, is when you take over something that has never been successful, how hard it is to change it. And you got to be so tough, you got to be resilient, and you got to be able to deal with losing. Chris has never lost. Never in his life has he ever lost. And I was worried about that. And I mean, he handled it like a champ. He really did. And he's home, and he's in the best spot he can possibly be.
I think that's interesting, because there certainly had been a lot of speculation, Chris, that at some point this would be a job that would be available to you. And I think there was a lot of talk in the Northwestern community of just what you're saying. Would he be interested? Would his father let him take the job? Would Coach K let him take the job? Would they talk him out of the job? And I don't mean to say it, let him take, like, you know, like you were somehow in handcuffs and prevented from doing it, but would they talk you out of it? What swayed you that this was an opportunity and you had a chance to win where others, frankly, haven't?
Well, I think just looking at it from afar, you know, all the natural, you know, I was always big on fit, you know, and like he said, there's certain environments that just were very appealing to me. The high school I went to, the college I was at, being able to coach at a school, you know, for a long time, that's very similar to the socially, academically, the standard of excellence on the court, off the court, being that this was my hometown, a lot of friends, love Chicago. And maybe I'm kind of different. I kind of like the fact that it had never been done. You know, being at a place that had a legendary coach, you know, Coach K, who was a great mentor for me, if I were going to leave something like that, I wanted to go somewhere where I felt like I could build a program and kind of be that guy. And so, you know, like I think my dad said, my only thing was I needed to talk to the people that were I was going to answer to, that were the AD, the president, and I wanted to feel their vision. And, you know, certainly I had a vision, and I felt like there was a lot of potential here. You know, being in Chicago, to me, the best sports town in the country, being at a great school, being in the Big Ten, being at a place that you could only go up, I mean, from what we could build. And, you know, once I spent time with Jim Phillips and Morty, and felt their competitiveness, felt their energy, felt their passion. There was an instant connection. I just knew. I mean, sometimes with your decisions, you got to just trust your instincts. You know, and you got to take a leap of faith. I mean, I left a great situation, you know, probably the best assistant coaching job you could have. But at some point, you got to go for it. And I just felt like this was the perfect opportunity at the right time, you know, for me to build a program and have success.
You know, Dave, it's interesting because Coach K is a friend of mine, and we talked. Coach K came in for one of Chris's games last year,
right?
A Western Michigan game in the afternoon, and Coach was happy because Western Michigan scored 35 points that day. He was talking about the defense and everything and whatever. But before he left,
he wasn't talking about the offense.
Coach, we scorched it up with 51 that day. We got 51 on two late free throws, kind of thing. So, but Coach K put his arm around me as he was leaving, and you know, coaches. I mean, he looks at Chris and Wojo, and Coach had three daughters, and so he looked at Chris and Wojo and Johnny Dawkins and Tommy. Now, these are like his sons, kind of thing. And I never forget, he said to me, he said, Chris is in the right place. He said, I feel good. And he said, if I were 40, I would do this. And I thought that spoke a lot, that Coach K had that kind of feel for, he said, if I were 40 and I were Chris, I would want to build that something there too. It's going to be special.
It's interesting. We've talked a lot. Obviously, the nature of this conversation is your influence on Chris and how you guys have interacted with basketball, but you've had other mentors. You mentioned Brian James is here. Brian's right there. Obviously, Coach K has played a huge role in your life. How much did you bounce this off of them? What was kind of the equilibrium here of how much you talked to your dad, how much you talked to those guys, how much you talked to your wife and, you know, former teammates and all these people about this monumental decision?
Yeah, I mean, I think you got to be careful not to talk to too many people because everybody, right. You know, you got to really lock in on what's important to you and you got to take the input and then make your own decisions. But obviously Coach K was very influential, you know, certainly being in college, being around him, he has a great feel for the landscape of things. And just like my dad said, I mean, he was probably the biggest cheerleader for this whole situation for me. He felt at the stage I was at my life, what this program needed, where it was, the opportunity to make a mark, to leave an impact, to build something. I mean, he was kind of the driving one that you got to do this. It's too good. And not that it's not going to be hard. It's going to be real hard. But this is the one for you. So, and, you know, that meant a lot to me because certainly I wouldn't be here for not what he's done, but also Coach K. I mean, you know, I've been the last 8 years to be able to be on the U.S. Olympic national staff. I mean, that's just incredible, you know, to coach LeBron and Kobe and Dwayne Wade and all these guys and, you know, represent our country and to be at Duke for so long and to be in a position to have this job, you know, is because of Coach. So to have that input, to have his input, you know, those were probably the two biggest influences. And then, you know, obviously the boss at home has to make the final call, the wife. So, you know, once she said she'd be okay with living in Chicago, I think that kind of stamped it.
You guys picked a great winner to move here.
Exactly. I told her it wasn't that bad. And then I got a few dirty looks along the way this winter. So,
you know, also when he was going through this, I was still coaching in Philadelphia.
Right.
And I had probably with about 2 months to go in the year, you know, we had made the trade for Bynum, and we'd given so much away, and he couldn't play. And I knew that they were going to have to start all over. And I met with our owner, Josh Harris, who's a really, really nice guy. And I just let him know. I said, Josh, I'm going to step down at the end of the year because I know you're going to have to start all over. And at age 62, I can't take 60 losses. You need a different coach. You're going to need somebody who's going to have to come in here and put 2, 3, 4 years. And I said, I can't be that guy for you. And Philadelphia, you know, Dave, for people who don't, that city's so important to me. I went there when they were 9-73. That's when they drafted me. And 4 years later, we were playing Portland for a world championship. So that city, my daughter lives there. I have 3 grandkids there. I have family, my friends, a ton of people. That city is important to me, and I just felt like that it was time for me to step away. And so I guess I'm telling you this story because BJ was my assistant, and I wanted Chris to know that I wasn't going to coach next year. And so he reached out to BJ to be like that older coach who's been around 40 years plus of experience, somebody he really, really trusts. And that's the one thing that, so then with BJ coming here, I felt really good about that. And then obviously when you look at the staff here that Chris has, incredible, you know, Pat Baldwin, who, I mean, he's the guy who sits on that bench over there. He went through an 0-18 year. I mean, he was 0-18 in the Big Ten, you know, and a great, great player, and Armand and Pep in his step, you know, his video guy. And Chris Quinn, who was 6 years old when he moved to Chicago with his dad with United Parcel. They picked up the newspaper, read about Chris, and watched every one of Chris's high school games. Wore number 20 and now is on Chris's staff, you know, and Chris Lawton, who was his basketball op guy. Duke. I mean, you look at that. I mean, people don't realize the dynamics of that is the success of how you build something. And I'm really proud Chris has put together an incredible group of guys, incredible.
I'm going to open up to questions here momentarily in about 4 or 5 minutes, but I did want to ask, I know people are going to ask about that first year, but from your point of view, kind of reaction to what you and that staff went through this year, the highs, and there certainly were some pretty remarkable highs when you think about it, and also obviously the disappointment of maybe losing more than you ever had, as yeah. Your dad said.
I mean, I was really pleased with this year. I think you feel like you're ready to be a coach. You feel like you've been trained properly. You, from a coaching standpoint, I was given a lot of responsibility at Duke to media-wise, speaking at functions, a lot of the things head coaches have to do. But until you actually get in that role and you're in that seat and you see the demands of the time and all that you have to do and you have to learn to prioritize and put together a staff and, you know, that first month on the job, you know, I was laughing because one of my best friends is Wojo, who just got the Marquette job. And I'm looking at him right now, and he looks like I looked a year ago. You know, just that dazed look, like, what did I get myself into? You know, you just, you wake up every day, and there's just more things to do than there are hours in the day. And whether it's recruiting, getting to know your guys, working with your guys, figuring out your style, you know, training your coaches to do the things you want them to do, putting a staff together, all those things. But, you know, I think as we evolved, and it took us a while to kind of figure out who we were as a team. And, you know, part of that was I wanted to give all these guys an opportunity to, especially there were a lot of veterans that were back that had played a lot of games, had won games, you know, a couple guys, veteran guys that were right on the cusp of getting to the tournament. So, you know, we it took us a while to kind of figure out our style, how we could be successful. You know, I had a great group of guys. I tell you, the players, it's not easy going through a coaching change, you know, for the players. You know, they, whether it's right or wrong, it's everything's different. And there is no right way. There's no wrong way. and what the way they did things, the way they practiced, the way they played, and it was successful. Everything was new. So I almost felt like I had all freshmen, because you're just, it's all new terminology, it's all new way of doing things. And we kind of, you know, it took us in the non-conference, we had our bumps, we took our lumps, and you know, coming into the conference, you realize right out of the gate in the Big Ten, they didn't do me many favors. You play Wisconsin, Iowa, Michigan, you know, the first three games right out of the gate, and we got hammered. You know, I remember the first game, our home game, you're all excited, you're playing your first Big Ten game, and you walk in at halftime and you're losing 40-14. You know, it's it wasn't a good feeling. you know, so, you know, we kind of, it took us a while to figure it out, and there was no more fun journey than kind of trying to find a way to win. And we won that first game against Illinois here at home, which was an incredibly special night. It was an offensive explosion, 49-44. Just the way I love it. And, you know, we went on that run. We won 5 out of 7 games, and it was kind of like, man, what's going on? We won at Indiana. You know, my wife gets so mad at me. You know, we fortunately played great. We won in the Kohl Center, which not many people do, and especially as good as they were this year. And my wife got mad at me the whole year, every time. And I'm a basketball junkie, so, you know, that's one thing she doesn't understand. She's like, you're talking basketball, you're practicing basketball, you're doing all this, and you come home and the first thing you do is you put a game on. Like, what is that? You know, and so anytime I would be watching Wisconsin, you know, there'd be like 5 or 6 times during the game I would just say out loud watching the game, how the heck did we beat those guys? She's like, enough already. Like, we get it. But it's, you know, we were playing really well, and then, you know, Jershon Cobb got hurt, which was a huge loss because we just didn't have that many guys. We only had 10 guys we were playing, and Pat Baldwin and Armon Gates had to suit up every day in practice just so we could play 5-on-5. And, you know, we had a tough injury to Jershon. We lost 7 games in a row. And I think the thing I was most proud of is, you know, you talk about the culture and fighting hard and playing hard. And I think the thing that I was most proud of is the way we finished after losing 7 in a row. You know, we got drilled at home against Penn State. You know, we only scored 32 points. And it was senior night, and it was a tough night for everybody. And we still had to play at Purdue, and then we had to go to the Big Ten tournament. And we went to Purdue 2 days later, and we won on the road and played really well. And then we drew Iowa, who had absolutely annihilated us twice, beat us by about 30 both times we played them. And for our group of guys to go to the Big Ten tournament and to win, you know, it was, I get emotional about it just because, you know, it showed a lot about those guys, and it showed that we're on the right track. And, you know, sometimes it's not measured in wins and losses, and you don't fully get that. But, you know, the way we finished that year, it showed that there's a lot of good that's on the way.
You know, Dave, it's interesting. You know, you talk about a perspective. You know, when they lost their first 3, and they went 5-2, you know, and everybody's talking about, you know, wow, can they make the tournament, this and whatever. They had a tough home loss against Nebraska. I thought that was sort of the cusp game, you know, had they been able to win that game or whatever. But they lose the 7 in a row, and I remember talking to Chris, and I said, Chris, I want you to go back to the first night in the office after the 40-14 half against Wisconsin, where we're praying, like, can we get one? Can we get one? And I said, if I told you you were going to go 5-13 in the Big Ten on that night, would you have taken it? He said, yeah, I would have taken it. I said, well, you're 6-12, okay? The problem is like when you win 5 out of 7 and you lose 7 in a row, you're thinking about how you got to that 6-12 rather than the overall body of work. And that's the one thing I hope I've given him is just to understand, because the NBA is 100 games. You start going all these games and you're going to have highs and you're going to go all over the start. You know, at the end of the day, how did you get there? And then not only how did you get there, but what did you learn, not only about yourself, but the team, on how you got there? Because that's initially, that eventually is going to be what your roadmap is going to be. And as I sit here, it's interesting. This time last year, I flew in. Chris was staying in a hotel. I got the rollout cot, and we were getting up at 6 o'clock in the morning, and the guys were doing individual workouts, and I was coming in to watch. And I think about where he is right now, and it's like he grew about 10 years this year. It's pretty neat to watch.
Well, it's been neat for all of us to watch as well. I do want to open it up to questions now to make sure everyone who has something they want to ask either Coach Collins can do that. We do have a microphone, so I'll acknowledge you, and then we'll wait for the microphone for the question. Let's start over here.
Chris, I'm a Glenbrook North alum, class of 80, so welcome home. If I can go back to the days with your dad with the Bulls, did you ever get to go one-on-one with Michael, and what was that like?
Being a ball boy was great. You know, before the game, you get there early, and all the guys, you know, and I was always, I've always been a trash talker when I was a player, so I always had that kind of spunk. So I would go out there, and I'd be in my ball boy sweatsuit, and the guys were warming up, and I'd always, like, try to defend them, and they'd score on me and talk trash to me, and those were just really fun moments. You know, I remember my greatest moment, though, my greatest thrill being a ball boy was, I remember there was a playoff game, and it was right in the height, and the crowd, you know, the old Chicago Stadium was awesome. And what used to, the way guys come out really early and they shoot around and they warm up and then they go back into the locker room for like a final pregame talk that can last about 10 minutes, 15 minutes, and then they come out and they warm up. So they used to let me, I used to get in that interim time as people were, and this is like 25, 30 minutes before the game. So the crowd's starting to file in. And I remember, and I was just a young guy, I'm like in eighth grade. And I used to crank up NBA threes. And I remember one day I like got it going and I hit like 5 in a row, 6. And every time I made, the crowd started cheering more for me.
You didn't need that.
And so like I got it going and I'm, you know, 10 in a row, 11 in a row. Now they're like counting them out and I'm feeling myself a little bit. Now all of a sudden the teams and in the old Chicago Stadium, you know, they used to come out from the bottom. They used to walk up the steps. And the teams come out for warm-ups, and everybody in the crowd started booing because they wanted me to keep shooting. And that was one of my favorite moments. So
tell them the Michael story in the locker room before the one playoff game.
Well, you know, being a kid, and you know, for me, I grew up in sports, so I grew up around being in Philadelphia. I wasn't awestruck by a lot of people, but there's certain people that, you know, still an actor or there's a celebrity status that you're just kind of in awe. And, you know, Michael was that, you know, for me. So I remember the very first game, the opening night, I was in junior high. I'm 13 years old. I'm a little bit nervous. I'm a little bit scared. I'm like in the locker room. Guys are playing music and kind of getting ready for the game. So I'm in a corner just kind of listening to everything, taking it all in. So Michael comes in and, you know, he used to wear a brand new pair of Air Jordans every game. You know, it was just Nike had his foot molded. So, and then after the game, he would always sign them and give them to charity or give away his shoes. And, you know, but I didn't know all this. So I see him take this Air Jordan box, brand new pair of Air Jordans. And he takes it, he doesn't say a word, and he just like throws it in my chest. So I'm like holding this Air Jordan box and I'm like awestruck, I don't know what to do. So I take the box, and I had my backpack in the back, and I like opened my backpack, and I like put the shoes in my bag, like he was giving them to me. He goes, "What the hell are you doing?" I said, "What do you mean? What do you mean?" He goes, "I'm not giving you those shoes. It's your job to lace them up so I can play tonight." I said, "Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry." So I took them out. And so that became my job. Every game was I laced Michael's shoes up for him to play that night. So it was that was kind of my indoctrination to being a Bulls ball boy.
Pretty good job.
Yeah, it worked well. It worked well.
In the back here. I thought you did a great job with Alex Ola this year.
Thank you.
From the beginning of the year to the end. Can you tell us what you guys focused on with him and how you coached him for that much improvement?
Well, I think first of all, Alex worked incredibly hard and to develop his skill, and Brian James gets a lot of credit for that. You know, he works with our post guys, and on a daily basis, you know, Alex was in there watching film, he was working hard. But I think the moment, especially for bigger guys and coaches, know the power of confidence and belief in yourself. He kind of was a guy, and I knew he was under a lot of criticism, and he's not an overly confident kid. You know, he doubted himself. He struggled as a freshman. We really had no other option other than to just go with him. And the best way to get better is kind of to be thrown in the fire and have to figure it out. And I think as the season went on, he had a couple games where, even though we got killed the first game we played Wisconsin, he had like 22 points and 10 rebounds, and you know, he was really good, and he had success against Frank Kaminsky, and who was a really good player. And you know, I think I just saw like kind of the way he started walking around, like he was had his chest up a little more. He was a little cockier when you talk to him. When I first got here, I had a thing with him, because I could sense he was insecure about his game. He's from Romania. It's a great story. You know, when I first got the job, he when I met with him, he said, "Coach, I really want to be good, but I just want you to show me how, you know, and I just want to be coached." And so we worked with him every day. He had a great attitude, and he got better, and he saw success, and I just saw his confidence just continue to grow. And the last month of the season, I mean, he was in the upper tier of big guys in the Big Ten, and he just kept playing better and better. He started hitting threes, you know. He started hitting shots and doing three signals, and I'm like, man, he's getting it. He's getting there. And what's exciting is he was just a sophomore, and I think a lot of times, especially with college players, and like there's such an instant gratification now in college sports. It used to be, now with this one and done model and people going pro. It's like if you're not a starter and a great player as a freshman, you're a failure. And it's different people. We always say just run your own. You got to run your own race. And some guys can come in and be great players as freshmen. Other guys, it takes time. You know, you got to work. You got to get better. You got to get stronger. And you look at Alex now. I mean, he still has two full years to play, and he's only going to keep getting better. And that's what I'm excited about. Is I think we have one of the best big guys in the Big Ten. You know, for two more years.
I couldn't be a bigger fan of both of you. Starting with you, Doug, I follow your career as a coach and I love your broadcasting work.
Thank you.
You're the best color analyst in the history of the game.
Thank you so much.
I love listening to you on Countdown, Phil Simmons, and Jalen. And my question, I have one for each of you if I could, but my question for you is when you think back to as a parent, and Chris was looking at schools, can you talk a little bit about what that was like for you as a coach and as a parent, helping him evaluate and look at programs and think about playing time fit and where it made the most sense to go, and obviously looking at Coach K as a coach as well, getting the background.
Well, it's sort of interesting. Duke really had never seen Chris play, and they used to have a play at an event called the Morris Shootout, and they invited the best high school teams or whatever. They'd come down there and they'd play like for 2 days. They'd play like four or five games. You know, King was there. They were really good. Collinsville had Richard Keene. Proviso, Quincy, they had all the programs or whatever. And I'll never forget because Chris was playing on the one court and then there was a middle or whatever and the game was going on. And all of a sudden, all the people started moving down this way because Chris really had a role in this. They had like 48 against Quincy or whatever. And afterwards, I was leaving the gym. And, you know, Duke was always a school I wanted to go to, but I wasn't good enough to go. I wasn't good enough to play there. They didn't recruit me. And I always felt like that would be a great fit for Chris, just what it's all about. Now, I wasn't going to tell him that, but I was hoping at some point in time they would recruit him. And I'll never forget, we went to a Wendy's to get a sandwich between the games, and I saw Coach K in the parking lot. And I said,
conveniently. He just happened to be at the Wendy's we were at. So.
So I'm starting to walk in, and I remember he said, "Hey, Doug," or whatever. And I said, "Hey, Coach, how you doing?" "I love Chris." And I went, "Wow, that's pretty neat." And so I guess what I'm saying is I knew Chris liked the bright lights. You heard the steroid story when he was in Chicago Stadium shooting in eighth grade. I knew he wanted to go somewhere where basketball was going to be big, it was going to be exciting. But I said, Chris, understand one thing. I mean, that competition, when he went there, they had Bobby Hurley, Grant Hill, Thomas Hill, I mean, loaded. And every year they're going to keep getting more and more. I said, Chris, if you go there, man, you're going to have to fight your tail off. And he did. And he had a hell of a career there for doing it. But I wanted him to go to a school that he was going to be around people that he had been around his entire life who were incredibly successful, who were incredibly driven. That kid in the classroom who was trying to do as good in the classroom as he was trying to do on the court. And so I just feel like the more competitiveness people you're around, that you either get swallowed up by it or you meet it. And so my daughter's the same way. She went to Lehigh and she played basketball there. She was the MVP of the Patriot League as a freshman. And so I'm proud that my kids chose competitive spots, great academic spots, and spots that will always be home for them. They always go and it's going to be home because they're incredible people who go to those kind of places. And that's the only thing I really talk to him about is think about down the road when you're done what you want to be able to do. And can you imagine sitting next to Coach K for 13 years?
Just thinking back, I grew up in Berlin, Philadelphia, and then Berlin, New Jersey, just a few miles from where you guys were. But I'm thinking back as a 13-year-old, 1972, watching TV on a Saturday night, and I guess it was early September, I believe, on a black and white television. And I was so sick to my stomach as a 13-year-old, I still can't watch the documentary when I see it on TV. But 30-some years later, 2008, I remember the moment when that gold medal happened and all those players came over to you and Chris as an assistant coach on the same team. I know that didn't give you closure, but certainly I want to just maybe take through the emotions, not the first game, but the 2008 game.
What he's talking about is, you know, in 72, we got the, you know, they kept putting more time back on the clock and eventually the Soviets won the gold medal game. So, it was sort of in 2008, Coach K was coaching the team, and he asked me if I would come in and speak to the team before they left to go to Beijing. And I took it as a great compliment. You know, Coach K and Jerry Colangelo are not going to open up their locker room to just anybody. And so I really thought long and hard about the message I wanted to give these guys. And I really spoke from my heart about what the experience they were getting ready to go through. I talked to them about other countries view a gold medal bigger than they would view an NBA championship ring. I remember saying to them, if the gold medal is as important to you as it is to the other countries, we will not lose. And I told them a little story about the last song I heard before we played the Olympics in 1972, I used to go in to listen to music, and it was a song by Jimmy Ruffin, and it was called What Becomes of the Brokenhearted. And I said, when I listened to the words of that song, it's what happened. I got my heart broken. And I said, the last song I want you to hear is the national anthem. That's my wish for you. I didn't get to hear it. So before every game, as I was doing the broadcast, all the players would look over to me like, hey, coach, this, you know, we got you. So when they won, LeBron jumped over. I mean, I still have my headset on. I had a great picture in my office of him giving me a hug and saying, you're a part of this or whatever. And then after it was over, they brought me out on the court. They all put their medals, gold medals around my neck, and they took a picture with me because they knew how important it was for me. Well, if you fast forward to that, to 2009, when I went to the Hall of Fame, we had a dinner afterwards, and we're all sitting there, and I could see Chris starting to fidget a little bit and whatever, and I said, Chris, what's going on or whatever? And he said, well, I have something for you. And he reached into his pocket, he stood up, and he said, you got your gold medal now, and it's hanging in my house.
We have Will Kunkel, who's a Medill grad. He wants to know, how do you leverage your relationships with pro coaches and pro players in your recruiting process?
Well, you know, I think recruiting, a lot of it is about relationships, but also for, you know, guys, young players to see a fit. You know, there's a lot of things that go into it. You know, I think the fact that I've had the experiences I've had, that I've had the chance to coach some of the players I've coached, and then especially now the connection of being able to coach the NBA guys for the last 8 years, and you know, having the relationships with the NBA coaches, the general managers. I think you know, all these kids have dreams, just like I did. All the young guys have they want to play in the NBA. You know, and they want to have a chance to see that dream, you know, come through. And so I think they know, the players know that, you know, I'm someone that has those relationships, that if they're good enough, you know, there's not anyone in the NBA that is not going to respect me or anyone on my staff giving them a call and recommending players. But, you know, I think it works to our advantage, you know, and I think, you know, that's the thing you have to do in recruiting is, you know, I'm not big on negative recruiting and trying to shoot down what other people, you know, may, and that's what a lot of people do in recruiting. They try to negatively recruit other schools. And what I've always tried to do is just focus on the positives. You know, first of all, I think the situation we're at, and I've talked about it before, with the city we're in, the school we have, the conference we play in, the schedule we play, the exposure, you know, the opportunity to play for our staff. You know, we're hungry, we're young. And I think the challenge of being, there's nothing like being the first, you know, no matter what. You know, I see the way, you know, Coach K's won almost 1,000 games. He talks about that first group in a different way than he talks about anyone else, because those were the first group of guys, Johnny Dawkins, Jay Billis, who's now with ESPN, Tommy Amick, they were the first group of guys that kind of believed in him before he was Coach K. And that's where we're at. You know, that's where we're at. We're starting. And, you know, we're looking for a bunch of guys that are excited about the challenge, just like I was, you know, just to take the leap that I did. I came here because I believe in the school. I believe that we can build a basketball program and do it the right way. And so more than anything, that's kind of what we talk about, is that vision, that dream of where we want to go. And, you know, that's, but you want to also use your relationships, and, you know, that's what it's all about in any business. And we try to do that as well.
Thanks. So first, I'm a Philly native and a Lehigh alum, so thanks for all the shout-outs up there. But Doug, I have a question for you, because you mentioned over-preparing for games when you're a broadcaster or an analyst. And I'm curious if you could tell us what your preparation is like and how that's different from preparing as a coach.
Okay, great question. I was always taught, you have to understand, I had no broadcasting background. I mean, speech 101 in high school, for me to stand up, I was like, I wouldn't sleep for a couple days. I was incredibly blessed to be around the greatest play-by-play guys in the world when I first started cutting my teeth. The Gary Benders, the Brent Musburgers, the Frank Gliebers, all these incredible stars. And they taught me. As you know, in broadcasting, or in, there's an old thing, expect the unexpected. Expect the unexpected. So let me give you an example. We were in Boston Garden one night doing a game, and the referee blew a hamstring. We had 30 minutes to fill. There was no studio. We had 30 minutes to fill. So Dave understands what kind of information are you going to have now to this unexpected thing, or a shot clock bust, or backboard breaks. You got to be prepared. But my preparation is such that when I'm doing a game, let's say I was doing Portland and the Spurs tonight, I would go back and I would watch the last three games both of them played. And I would watch, and I would try to watch how they're playing, who's playing well, who's not playing well, the matchups, how coaches are substituting. I would listen to the local announcers, because they have a great flavor for the team. because they're around the team every single day. I would do probably 25 hours of reading for the one game. We have a we'd have a conference call 3 days before the game, about 2 hours, where the people would ask me, Coach, break the game down. Strength, weaknesses, how they match up, build all of our graphics for the game. Go to the city the night before, get together, have dinner if we could with the guys I'm working with, because I'm a firm believer the more time you spend with those people, that everybody has a lot invested. And that's the one thing that, and Dave will tell you, you know, you hear his voice, you hear his partner's voice, but there's a stat guy next to him, there's camera guys, there's producers, there's directors. It's an incredible team effort. And the one thing I've always tried to do is before every game, go back in the truck and make sure I knew everybody's name who was working back there to make them feel like they're important, because they can hang your ass out real fast if they want to. Okay, real quick. Okay, the headset, all kinds of stuff, all right? Make those people feel like they're on the team. On the day of the game, we'd have a breakfast. And for 2 hours again, I would present stuff to them again. They wanted me to talk because they figured me to be the professional from the basketball standpoint. Our producer and director would talk about different things, storylines. Go to the arena, our play-by-play guy would do interviews, we'd hopefully get a sit-down. An hour before the game, I would get 15 minutes with each coach, and then I'd get away, and I'd break down my stats, and I'd break it down, I color-code it. So red is strength, green is weakness, blue is last year. And so when I'm doing a game, I have this in front of me. So I know what guys have done this year, what they've done well, where they've struggled. They have a sheet called a Hubie sheet that is a breakdown of teams' offensive numbers and their defensive numbers this year and last year. And so I study that. Because what I want to be able to do, numbers to me don't mean anything unless they tell a story. So when I'm speaking, if I can say, so-and-so in his last three games is 3 for 18 from three, but he hit his first four tonight. That tells a story rather than say he's 3 for 22. So I when you have a graphic, I want a graphic to be able to be as such to where if I'm speaking about it, you easily comprehend what I'm talking about. It's not blasted with numbers. Too many numbers run together. And my essence of broadcasting is a game is a story. First of all, there's the beginning. So I get 2.5 minutes to try to tell you why you should watch this game. How can I hook you into watching this game? With all the stuff that's going on, why would I give you the next 2.5 hours? Then to me, you have from the first quarter to the third quarter, it's about stories of players that make them personal, so that when you hear their stories, they become other than just a number to you. They become a person. I learned that in doing the Olympics. So if everybody has their own story. So it might be a so-and-so goes to the free throw line and I tell a story while he's shooting a free throw. Substitutions, matchups, that kind of stuff. Fourth quarter, it's all about game and strategy. So to me, it's beginning, middle, end, and then you wrap it up with a bow at the end, and you got the book, you got the story. And it's a story one way or the other. But I was always taught also one thing, hang your hat on something before it starts, not after. And you're either right or you're wrong. But hey, watch this tonight. And to me then what happens is that when I do a game, I don't want to speak coach speak. I want to speak in a language that the basketball junkie enjoys. But when it's playoff time and we got the casual viewer tuning in, I want them to be able to understand what I'm saying too.
Hi, I'm Kim Adams. I'm a grad student here at Medill, and another Philly connection. I was playing at Penn when you were coaching the Sixers.
Okay.
Sophie's
my
there.
Son-in-law went to Penn.
Oh.
School of Finance.
Okay.
Much
awesome.
Smarter man than his father-in-law. Believe me.
I doubt that. So you talked a little bit about how when Chris was looking into Northwestern, you were kind of ho-hum on it, kind of kept your mouth shut. Now that he's coaching, and when you're watching these games and you see, you know, I don't know how well this is working, I think this might be better. How much do you offer up your own insight, and how much do you kind of take a step back and say, you know what, this is his team. I'm going to let him figure this out.
I hope the latter. I don't know of many times that I talked X's and O's with Chris this year. What I try to do is balancing in the losing and going through the building and how hard it is to keep him on the big picture aspect of it. The great thing about it is he's got this incredible staff. And I want to be one of these guys when I walk in one of their practices or I sit in a meeting with them that they want me there. That they go, oh shit, he's here tonight, you know. I would want him that hey, you know, and what I'd like to do, and I think these guys would tell you, is I've got 45 years of experience. So when something happens, I might share, hey, guy, you know, been down that road before. You know, it might be walking out of the arena and seeing a player leave, and he's got his head down and he's beaten. And I say, it's about X's and O's. You need to put your arm around that kid tomorrow. Just something like that. And I guess I'm one of these guys that's always been, I don't want to be on the bandwagon and parade. I don't want to be on the float. I want to be there with you before the parade happens. And then when you get to the parade, you won't see me.
I think, unfortunately, we have run out of time. I apologize for that. I do want to thank everyone for coming. Thank you to Medill for hosting this. And thanks to Doug and Chris.
Thank
this
you,
was
Doug.
Really
thank you, Doug.
Phenomenal.
Thank you, man.
Great
thank you, man. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Have a great night.